Commission on Racial Equality Strategy. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. One amendment has been selected and is published on the Marshall list. The proposer of the amendment will have 10 minutes to propose and 5 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. I'll ask the clerk to read the motion.
That this Assembly recognises the positive contribution that ethnic minorities make to our society, notes with concern an increase of 87% in hate-related crime in the last 4 years, and calls on all ministers to continue to give priority to implementing the Racial Equality Strategy and the Together Building a United Community Strategy, and to providing the financial support to ensure that both of these strategies are supported and implemented.
I call Mr Sean Lynch to move the motion. Mr Lynch.
I move the motion and not supporting the amendment. Sinn Féin is fully committed to implementing the two strategies within the motion, the Racial Equality Strategy and TEPO. We're fully committed. Can call you. First, I think it's important to outline the positive contribution that ethnic minorities make to our society. They provide substantial economic and social benefits to the north of Ireland. A recent report written by two academics from Queen's University said about 4% of the workforce is made up of migrant workers. It's reported that they contribute more in tax than used in services. The report highlights contributions in taxes, labour and cultural diversity, enriching our society rather than threatening it. We frequently hear claims that migrants take our jobs and use up our limited services. The truth is that they're vital to this economy. We as political leaders and elected representatives need to stand up for a vision of an open, tolerant and outlooking society. Mind you, the tone of the rhetoric emerging from last week's Conservative conference, comments on immigration and foreign workers could be described as toxic and sending out the wrong message, making people fearful and feeling vulnerable. We need to challenge prejudice and prejudicial attitudes at every level of society. Figures quoted in the recent CERD report stated that 14% of 9-10-year-olds and 8% of 12-13-year-olds were bullied because of their colour. That is the ones that came forward. That is the ones we know about. There are silent voices out there who keep quiet until it's too late. Minority ethnic students experience lower levels of belonging and higher levels of exclusion. Schools tend to lack the knowledge and awareness needed to deal with issues of ethnic minorities and how they find themselves in certain situations. We had the incident of a woman who was at the airport to pick up her mother, waiting in the cafe, was asked to produce her identity. When she showed her passport, her son asked, "Mommy, do we have to carry our passports at all times?" This was a woman, simply because of her colour, had to show her passport to prove she belonged to here is wrong. In recent weeks, we have had a number of calls about more needing to be done to tackle racial discrimination. It is in a recent report on the European Commission against Racism and Intolerance has called upon all political parties to stand firm against intolerance, discord, and instruct their representatives to refrain from making derogatory comments targeting a group of persons on the grounds of their race, religion, language, ethnic origin, sexual orientation, or gender identity. The report makes a total of 23 different recommendations to the UK government. One of those recommendations includes implementation of an equality strategy. In the UN report on concluding observations on elimination of discrimination, it sets out a plan to achieve a vision of where we live in a society free from fear and intimidation. While the report welcomes the positive action taken by this Assembly in the publication of the Racial Equality Strategy 215 to 225, however, it does express concerns that the North of Ireland does not have an Equality Act. The UN Committee also calls for the adoption of a Bill of Rights for the North of Ireland. The UN Committee report also notes with concern the reduction in resources for Human Rights Commission. Measures are adopted are meaningful and relevant. Adopted measures that to aid the increase of reporting of racist hate crime. The Human Rights Commission too, in its submission to the UN committee, has raised concerns about no single Equality Act here in the North. It is also important to note that the Equality Commission has called for an Equality Act, and the Commission has a paper on its website listing the disparities. The Equality Commission has also highlighted that black and minority ethnic individuals in the north of Ireland have less protection against racial discrimination, harassment and victimisation than people in other parts of the UK. They have produced a paper on race equality law reform, strengthening legal protection. Race and hate crimes here are disturbing, and appeal for political leaders to highlight the positive impact of inward migration. It is sad that today the people living in the north of Ireland, in particular the foreign national population, have never felt more insecure regarding the vulnerability to crime. Sinn Féin believe that everyone has the right to freedom from fear, and this is a challenge for policing and judicial system to meet. This is a challenge that must be met with without prejudice and respect for human rights. Racism is prevalent and it needs political leadership. Sinn Féin welcomes the announcement by the Ireland Human Rights Commission that it is investigating the issue of travellers' accommodation. The Chief Commissioner commented that the Commission completed a scoping exercise in June 2016, which identified significant human rights concern on a potentially systemic level. Its findings concluded that human rights examination of this issue is necessary. The Commission will publish its findings in the autumn of 2017. One has to ask in the 21st century, where is the equality of justice, opportunity, dignity without discrimination for every man, woman and child of the travelling community? According to Eleanor Roosevelt, where do universal human rights begin? In small places close to home, so close and so small that they cannot be seen on any map of the world. Yet they are the world of the individual person, the neighbourhood he or she lives in, the school or college he or she attends, the factory, farm or office where he or she works. Can I call you to conclude? Everyone living in the north of Ireland has the right to equality before the law and has the right to the equal protection and benefit of the law without discrimination on the ground of race, colour, ethnic origin, nationality, gender or gender identity, sexual orientation, disability, age, social or economic status, martial or family status, residence, language, religion or belief, politics or other opinions. That's the goal we should all work towards.
Call Mr. Doug Beattie to move the amendment.
Chair, thank you. I suppose we all look to our experiences while dealing with black and ethnic minority communities, be that when they come to your constituency office and you talk to see what issues they have, whether we see it on the street or on the news, whether you notice it when you're on holiday, how things are slightly different in a cultural sense. I spent 7 months living with a Hazara people in a village, and I quite seen, as the guy who was the ethnic minority living there, what it must be like for them living here, because I was the ethnic minority. I spoke to the wakils and I spoke to the imams and the village elder, and I tried to understand the culture. I went out of my way to try and eat their food continuously, to wake when they woke, went to bed when they went to bed, and understand them culturally. I tried to learn about their religion, and I tried to offer them my religion and my culture, but I found it extremely difficult. I felt like an outsider. I felt alienated. I felt isolated. And that must be what it's like for those who come to live here from minority communities, who try to integrate but find it incredibly difficult no matter what they do. And it's that difference which is the real problem. I welcome the motion for Mr. Lynch, and I welcome he brings it to the floor for debate. But I've got to say, his words do not match the motion. The motion is weak. It is a soft ball being bounced around the executive. It is not pushing the issue forward. It is the same argument we had 2.5 years ago. The Ulster Unionist Party amendment. Yes, absolutely.
I thank the member for giving way. Would he agree with me that our BME communities could be forgiven for thinking they're not a priority? They had to wait 5 years in the absence of a strategy, and every year groups don't get the decision on their funding in time, and there has been no review of the race relations order despite it being agreed by the Assembly close to 10 years ago.
I absolutely agree. I mean, we need to drive this issue forward. I mean, 2.5 years ago we had this debate, so we need to take that now and we need to move things forward. And that's what our amendment is all about. It's about setting an action plan. It's about setting a timetable, which is important. And it's about setting key priorities. It was absolutely no good sitting in the corner, doe-eyed, like a puppy looking up and saying we have an issue without actually driving that issue forward. So our amendment does give the BME communities strength in this motion. It gives an intent in this motion. And I really would ask people to think before they decide to vote against it. Of course, we have laws here which deal with our two-tier equality strategy. That's the Race Relations Act 1997 and the Fair Employment Treatment Order 1998. But the European Commission Against Racism and Intolerance believes that Northern Ireland should consolidate its equality legislation and take inspiration from the Equality Act 2010. Now, we haven't got that. We all know why we haven't got that. That's an argument for a different day, but it's something we really need to be driving towards. Now, when we think about the BME community, I guess we all think about Romanian migrant workers who come here, who set up home, who put down roots here and live amongst us. I guess we think about the Portuguese community, the Polish community and the Lithuanian community who now live amongst us. I think that's what we all think about. And if you go out into the community, you'll have people complaining, saying that these communities are filling our NHS and they're filling our A&E. Well, the answer is yes, they are. They are filling our NHS and they are filling our A&E. They're filling it with doctors. They're filling it with nurses. They're filling it with skilled labour. They're filling it with non-skilled labour. They are absolutely part of the community and they are valued part of the community. And with that, I absolutely agree with Mr. Lynch. But there are other groups what we have to look at as well, such as the Roma Gypsies or the Irish Travellers. They are no different and they are all in need of help as well. And all of these groups, we really have to look at how we can address measures to support them, including education, employment, healthcare and accommodation. And the case of Irish Travellers, making sure we have caravan sites. Yesterday we had a very heartfelt debate on Syria. We know that there's refugees who are coming out on Syria. Well, we need an integration program for those people who are coming out from Syria, who are coming to live here. And we can't be having this debate in 2.5 years saying we're going to have one. We need to do it, and we need to do it now, and that's what our amendment is all about. The European Commission Against Racism and Intolerance, and I'll read, calls upon all political parties to take a firm stand against intolerance discourse and instruct their representatives to refrain from making derogatory comments targeting a group of persons on ground of their race or ethnic origins. And it goes on to talk about sexuality, but I'm not going to get into that. So we have something that we really need to do as political representatives. We need to watch our words and we need to give out a firm commitment to the people from the BME community that we are going to support them. If you remember back a while to some of the words from Peter Robinson, where he said of the Muslim community he'd be happy to send them to the shops. Now, fair enough, he apologised, and I absolutely believe it was a slip of the tongue. But it was, yes, absolutely.
As well, using language that at least implies that people who are refugees are similar to dogs is perhaps not appropriate either.
Well, I stand and I answer, but you know, you're asking me what is the absolute obvious. Of course, and if you'd let me go on to say, I would have said that Peter Robinson did apologise for what he said, absolutely, and I was going to say there was no inference that he meant what he said. It was a slip of the tongue, but we all need to be concerned of that slip of the tongue. If we look at the Sinn Féin motion and Derry and Strabane saying that they want to ban Israeli goods, I can understand what they're trying to do. I don't agree with it, but I understand what they're trying to do. But by doing that, they raise the stakes against the Jewish community that is here. So we have to be careful about our words. So there's no point standing up and saying we need to support our BME communities and then allow your councillors to bring forward a motion like that, which alienates part of those very people we're here to try and protect. I acknowledge, and again I thank Mr Lynch for bringing forward this motion. I'm glad we're getting the opportunity to debate it on the floor. I hope people listen to the debate and don't just make up their minds and walk through a lobby because that's the easy thing to do. I hope they think about it. And what we are proposing is that there's an action plan, a timetable, key priorities, and all of our departments and ministers are held to account, because it doesn't sit with just the First and Deputy First Minister, because it sits with the Minister of Finance, it sits with the Minister of Education, it sits with the Minister for Health, and they need to come together to come up with a strategy and set those targets. So again, I acknowledge the motion, but I move the Ulster Unionist Party amendment. Thank you. Yeah.
Call Mr. William Irwin.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I first of all say I believe in Northern Ireland we pride ourselves in being friendly and welcoming people, and indeed this has been acknowledged in survey after survey and review after review by those in the travel industry and in many media outlets across the world. However, we are also well aware that on occasions we have unsavoury element in society raises its head, and this can be in the most sickening of ways. Taxing any individual or indeed any race is absolutely wrong and can never be reasoned as anything other than a criminal act, which deserves the most stringent punishments. My own constituency in Tarnragee, only a few days ago, a young Eastern European family was targeted in an attack which left them terrified and feeling that they could no longer stay in that particular area of the town, and indeed they have since moved away. The gang targeted the house and broke the glass in the rear door of the property. That is concerning, and a concerning incident, and thankfully the family, including their baby, were unharmed in that attack. However, attacks such as this leave a very real feeling of vulnerability amongst the victims, and that is the unseen impact of many of these attacks. There was also the sinister footage from last week which surfaced of young schoolboys abusing a Romanian woman, which was a shocking incident, and indeed all the more worrying given that the young school children were the ones hurling the abuse and using terminology which was very distasteful. It is clear, given the type of hurtful and racist comments that were used, that there is indeed work to be done in changing attitudes, perception and perceptions across all age groups, including amongst school children. The view of the majority in Northern Ireland is, of course, one of tolerance and respect. And in my own constituency, I know that there are a number of large businesses who heavily rely upon staff from the ethnic minority background. And in many cases, workers from the ethnic minority background make up the bulk of the workforce, make a very valuable and vital contribution to those companies. Indeed, this is repeated within companies and organisations right across Northern Ireland. However, there are, of course, very worrying incidences of people being trafficked to Northern Ireland by criminal elements and made to work in unacceptable conditions. This has again came to light in recent days. where a Romanian gang master appeared in court for help keeping 15 people in a three-bedroom house against their will, taking their wages and telling them they had, when they rightly complained of the conditions and of hunger, that they could eat stones. That is a shocking state of affairs, and more shocking given that this gang master had a string of convictions in all countries. In my own constituency, operating a full-time constituency.
I will, yes. Okay. I appreciate the member for giving way. At the end of the last mandate, this House, by I think it was 90 votes to 9, passed the human trafficking legislation. The instruments now exist in statute for those who exploit people, traffic people and exploit people in the way that the member describes in his constituency. The instruments now exist for judges to issue severe penalties. And does he agree with me that that's what needs to be happening in cases like that?
Thank you, member.
Member has an extra minute.
Can I thank the member for his intervention? Can I say that I fully believe, I believe that the full rigours of the law should be brought to bear on those responsible? Can I say in my own constituency, operating a full-time constituency advice service, I assist many people, including those from an ethnic minority background, and many within this category who contact me are in full-time work, in very good employment conditions, and are keen to remain in employment in Northern Ireland. I know that the executive has a responsibility in regards to the matters outlined in the motion, and there's a matter that ministers within my own party are taking very seriously and will continue to tackle head on to help change attitudes and confront racism in any form. Thank you.
Call Mr. Richie McPhillips.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, as SDLP spokesperson for the Executive Office, I welcome the opportunity to contribute to this today's debate on the issue that has, at least prima facie, gotten much worse in recent years, considering the increase in race-related crimes. Mr. Speaker, issues such as race and immigration have raised its ugly head across the UK and Northern Ireland in recent months, and it is concerning that the north of Ireland is often labelled as a racist state. And it must be said that, especially in Great Britain, racism attacks have been exacerbated by the decision of England and the Wales to leave the European Union, which has brought within it a sad state of affairs. Mr. Speaker, racism and xenophobia takes many forms in our society, and is actively disadvantaging people based on their race, ethnic background and their religion. Today's debate is timely, as there is a lack of clarity on the future British government policy regarding immigration, and there is yet to be a very clear reassurance to the emigrants or migrants who have chosen to make their home here in the north. Mr. Speaker, as we discuss today's motion, it is of utmost importance that this Assembly acknowledges that migrants make a huge contribution to our society. Madam Speaker. From the local economies to providing key roles in our health service and our tourism sector. Without this contribution and without the cultural variation that exists, the North would be a much more depressing place to live, and our public service would be mostly likely to collapse. Madam Speaker, despite this, and perhaps most worryingly, the most recent PSNI figures from June 2016 show that racist attacks continue to be a scourge on our society. In the 12 months to June, there were 1,113 incidents recorded where there was a racist motivation, of which 700 contained one or more crimes. This means, Madam Speaker, that each day in Northern Ireland there are a worrying 3 hate crimes reported to the PSNI. And only yesterday, in the Irish News, they reported that the period, the 1st of April to the 1st of October this year, there were 600 hate crimes. These were reported, and Madam Speaker, this underscores the big issue that is across the North and that immediate action must be taken. Madam Speaker, such crimes are intolerable, and it is my opinion that the vast majority of people in the North of this island are repulsed and disgusted by racist attacks. But we must acknowledge that there are certain sections of our society who have certain prejudices, and this executive has failed to address them with due inaction. They have failed to permeate the deeply held views in some of our most deprived communities that tackling this must be a main priority during this mandate as we move closer to the programme of government. Madam Speaker, since the last racial equality strategy expired, it has taken almost 10 years to produce another, and this is mostly due to the mounting pressures from the Equality Commission and other organisations, who have clearly identified gaps in provision here and have called on the Executive to drive forward and implement a racial equality strategy. But despite the publication of the new strategy and all its commitments, for example, in attempting to tackle bullying at schools, in calling for a review into fair employment legislation and a promise to tackle racial crime. But, Madam Speaker, the only progress that has been made to date has been an appointment of a subgroup and racial equality champions. These are welcome developments and have an important role, but there has to be a fundamental failure to include any action plan. There's no specific timeframes, nor has there been a correct level of resources used for the implementation. We have no responsibility and no accountability. Madam Speaker, if this Chamber and the Executive want to take racism seriously, it must properly invest in and develop a coherent action plan. Otherwise, any advancements will only be tokenistic in nature and will not end the plight of racism that many people suffer on a daily basis. It is for this reason, Madam Speaker, that I support and my party will support the Ulster Unionist amendment to today's motion. We need to get serious on racism, and we would hope that the First and Deputy First Minister fully acknowledge the concerns raised today and take meaningful action to rectify them. We need the strategy to do what it says on the tin, that it provides ultimate protection for the ethnic minorities.
Can the member bring his remarks to a close?
That it educates and raises awareness and once for all tackles racial inequalities and racial hate crimes within the north of Ireland. Thank you, Madam Speaker.
I call Stuart Dixon.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. Can I first of all state that I welcome the opportunity to speak on this important issue today. And as other members in the Chamber have already noted and highlighted, racism is a profound problem in this community and this society. Indeed, we are often dubbed in the regional and national media as a race hate capital in Europe. There have recently been some decreases in reported racism, and that is to be welcomed. However, I think emphasis has to be placed on the word reported, and sadly and all too often it's the unreported crimes that are those which should give us the greatest concern. I'd like to begin by thanking our colleague Mr Lynch for bringing forward the motion on such an important issue, and we will be supporting the motion. But I have to say government really isn't doing its job. Because of the issues of racism in Northern Ireland that have become perhaps particularly more disturbing over the last number of years, and many of us in our own constituencies, and we've already heard of the types of incidents and issues that arise in our constituencies when it comes to race hate and crimes, I had somewhat expected to spend most of the time of what I was going to say discussing the complexities of dealing with racism in Northern Ireland and indeed the racial equality strategy itself. But rather, unfortunately and somewhat ridiculously, my argument is going to have to focus on another issue, and that's the failure of this executive, an executive delay. I'm standing with my party and opposition colleagues here, in fact somewhat bemused as Sinn Féin brings forward a motion calling on their own First Minister and his executive colleague Arlene Foster to implement this strategy. One wonders why Sinn Féin and the DUP criticise opposition when they seem themselves, as the opposition, to criticise their own ministers. It's not even the first time this week that their inability of the executive to function has resulted in their own parties having to come to the chamber with motions to try and motivate them to do their own jobs. And here we see the consequences of the lack of this action. A barely implemented strategy for dealing with a problem that, if not dealt with, will have continuing and ongoing damaging impact on the whole of Northern Ireland and our communities for decades to come. Racism in Northern Ireland, the strategy that we need to address this impacts housing, schools, jobs and healthcare, and yet somehow this strategy is being failed to be implemented. My colleague Chris Little recently received response to a question on the racial equality strategy with an update on how it was progressing. The answer outlined 3 points proposed in the strategy that had been acted upon. That's 3 out of 11. I don't think in anybody's book that can be seen as a success. Where is the Minister of Education today to update us on how he has identified ways to tackle racist bullying in schools? Where's the Minister of Justice to tell us about her plans to develop an approach to tackling race hate crime? Indeed, if any of this is actually happening at all. I will.
The member agrees with me that one of the deficiencies in the racial equality strategy was the absence of any indicators or any way of assessing how ministers are actually contributing to increasing or decreasing racism through their actions and their words.
And the member has an extra minute.
Thank you, Madam President. I totally agree. Has the fair employment legislation been reviewed? Has the delivery model for Minority Ethnic Development Fund been reviewed? On paper, dealing with racism is considered an important issue by this executive. Intrinsically linked to dealing with sectarianism, yet in practice, public policy is shaped more with dealing with those things that divide unionists and nationalists, nationalists and unionists. And the isolation that the ethnic minority groups feel in Northern Ireland is a result of being considered last. Is it that we're working so hard to heal our sectarian divisions that we ignore the divisions and problems of minority and ethnic communities here in Northern Ireland? We need to embrace the proposals of this strategy. We need to implement it in full, not small steps, but we need to develop it in full. We need to introduce a single equality bill. We need to harmonise and update existing equality and anti-discrimination measures, and we need to strengthen equality provisions. A bill to revise fair employment monitoring to ensure that monitoring better reflects the diversity of mixed and multiple identities here in Northern Ireland. Principal Deputy Speaker, I want to extend my support to the amendment because the issue of racism in Northern Ireland needs to be dealt with at every level of government. And indeed, as Mr Carroll has said, without an action plan, without a timetable and without key priorities, the task is just the greater. A programme for government reflecting this obligation is what is required. So today, my plea on behalf of the Alliance Party is to implore the First and Deputy First Minister to prioritise this strategy. This chamber knows that what happens when irrational prejudices are allowed to fester in this society, in this community. It is important that we strive to overcome those prejudices, that we redirect them, that we redirect our resources towards the most vulnerable and the most isolated groups of people in Northern Ireland. The Alliance Party will be supporting the motion and the amendment. Thank you.
I call Pam Cameron.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to speak to this motion today. From the 1600s, Northern Ireland has had a long history of immigration, from the influx of Scots during the plantation of Ulster to the 19th century arrival of a large number of Italians. The past influences of immigrants can be seen everywhere in Northern Ireland, from the growth of the linen industry, which led to vast prosperity across the province, the beautiful marble and terrazzo in the Great Hall of this very building, and well, who hasn't been to the North Coast for an ice cream? Between 2000 and 2014, we in Northern Ireland have moved from a position of net migration loss to one of an annual population gain. During this period, it is estimated that around 175,000 people have settled here, which is a completely unprecedented position for us to be in. Immigrants are an intrinsic part of our culture, probably on a greater level than we even appreciate on a daily basis. Yet it seems that in recent times we have developed an attitude whereby immigration is something to be feared rather than celebrated. Whilst racially driven hate crimes have actually decreased in the last year, it's still at an unacceptable level. Incidents such as the recent attack on Jewish graves in the Belfast City Cemetery, and only last week in my own constituency, where three young men filmed and posted to social media footage of themselves racially abusing and throwing stones at a remaining woman. And this obviously highlights that there's still a massive amount of work to be done in how we view people of differing races and ethnic origins. It is, however, comforting for me to see the outrage that was demonstrated on social media by the local people of my hometown of Antrim to this revolting incident. I realise that much of the anxiety around immigration is caused by the misconception that people coming to live here are draining our public services. Of course, the increase in our population means that we must look at the number of available school places, the way we manage our healthcare system, and accessibility to social housing, all within the context of financial constraints. The economic and social contribution that immigration provides cannot be ignored. For example, due to the nursing shortages, our Department of Health has recently undertaken a programme of recruitment for nurses from the Philippines, Italy and Romania. And these nurses will deliver much needed assistance in our health trusts. And to be frank, we would be at an absolute loss without the care they are providing to us in our hospitals. It is estimated that around 30% of doctors and 40% of nurses working in the NHS within the UK were born abroad. And I cannot stress how much this assistance is to be applauded and welcomed. We are all aware of the pressures are on our health service, and I, for one, am grateful that we have such skilled individuals willing to take up the mantle and come to our country and work in our hospitals, surgeries, clinics, and look after us all as patients. In closing, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, the racial equality strategy seeks to tackle racial disparities, eliminate racism, and aims to encourage good race relations. It is only the start, but I hope that this is given the recognition it requires across departments. It is vital that we recognise the contribution culturally, socially and economically that immigration can bring to our society. I am pleased that each department has appointed a racial equality champion and hope that they will work proactively to implement, monitor and review how the strategy is working in practice. I feel that the workings of the subgroup alongside the executive office and departments will give a clear picture of areas which could be improved, areas which are working well and consequently bring a positive change in the delivery of the strategy. Whilst we currently have the lowest rate of immigration in the UK, I hope that in moving forward we continue to educate and inform people that immigration is not something to be afraid of and that we should embrace the cultural diversity it affords. Attacking people simply because they are of a different skin colour or speak another native language cannot be tolerated in our society, and I trust that all departments will bring the racial equality strategy and the societal change which will inevitably follow. Thank you. I support the motion.
Sir Philip McGuigan. I call Philip McGuigan.
Like everybody else, I welcome the opportunity to speak to today's motion. Muhammad Ali once said, hating people because of their colour is wrong, and it doesn't matter which colour does the hating, it's just plain wrong. Muhammad Ali is obviously correct, of course, but it's an unfortunate reality that racism does exist in our society today. Whether it takes the form of physical attack, attacks on property, graffiti, verbal abuse, bullying on social media, or the not-so-visible unequal access to jobs and services that others take for granted, racism is destructive to individuals and communities and needs tackled. Just yesterday, as Mr. McPhillips has already said, it was reported that over 500 race hate incidents take place here in the north in the last 6 months. That's between 2 and 3 race hate incidents a day, 2 and 3 a day. One race hate attack in any time period is one too many. When I think of the millions of Irish citizens who have left this island out of necessity at the time of the famine or the early 20th and late 20th century, and the various forms of treatment they received, both good and bad, when landing in America, Australia, England or elsewhere around the world, I think that we have an extra special duty here to welcome, embrace and support all those who come to these shores. Whilst the "no blacks, no dogs, no Irish" signs may be an iconic snapshot of a previous time, let's just hope that those sentiments remain where they belong in history. But they should serve as a reminder for us to remain vigilant to hatred. The 2011 census figures demonstrate the diverse nature of the minority ethnic community here. Over 32,000 people gave their ethnicity as something other than white. That figure will continue to grow, and I welcome the fact that that figure will continue to grow. As already has been said by my colleagues Sean Lynch and Doug Meady, people who come to Ireland add to our society. They add economically through their work and spend, but they also add culturally to our society. The world is now a smaller place, much smaller place than it used to be, and our neighbours may not have an O or a Mac in their surname any longer. So, while society is changing, it's important that our policies and practice change and adapt to the new situation. We must ensure that equality means equality for all. The racial equality strategy is a vital cog in that wheel, and this motion is calling to give this strategy priority and financial support to see it implemented. The strategy demonstrates a commitment to eliminate discrimination and promote equal opportunities and develop good relations. The racial equality strategy is key to identifying the real and varied needs of our ethnic minority population It identifies barriers that exist and how to overcome them, and raises awareness and helps focus responsibilities. I welcome the words of Martin McGuinness on the publication of the strategy when he said, "We must not just aspire to create a place where people can live, learn, socialise and work together regardless of race or ethnicity. We must all step forward and make it happen. Government alone cannot and will not eradicate racism and racial inequalities. There are already many people and organisations who are doing powerful work in their neighbourhoods, places of worship and workplaces to tackle racism. This strategy provides a platform for action to build on these efforts and generate further momentum." And just on those sentiments as well as welcome, can I praise those people in our community who are doing great work to make those who come to these shores' lives easier and to tackle racism. And particularly in my own constituency, I want to thank the work of the Ballymena Ethnic Minority Forum. And whilst I agree with the comments of Martin that government cannot do this alone, like others have said, I think that politicians have an important role in trying to eliminate racism. Whether it's discussing this subject, migration, refugees, conflicts across the world, even the subject of Brexit, we need to be careful with our language. Sometimes what we say and how we say it produces consequences. And that has already been said, and I just want to take exception to Doug when he tried to compare imposing economic sanctions, as was used against apartheid South Africa, with derogatory comments denigrating people because of their ethnicity. Moving on, I'm glad that the United Nations Committee and this report on elimination of racial discrimination welcomed the racial equality strategy as a positive step, as a roadmap to tackle the issue of racial discrimination. I'm less happy that the UN report had to point out that in the absence of an Equality Act here in the North, that
and
we still face challenges
to
combat racism. So in winding, Madam Deputy Speaker, I just want to support this motion and call for it to be implemented along with an Equality Act here in the North in the future.
I call William Humphrey.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. And I rise to speak not as a member of the Executive Committee but as a member of this House for North Belfast. The Belfast Jewish community continues to make an important and valued contribution to the lifeblood of Belfast. At sunset tonight, Jews across the globe will celebrate Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. Across Europe, synagogues will have armed guards because of the risk of attack on those places of worship. In the past few years, deadly attacks on kosher shops in Paris, a synagogue in Copenhagen, and a Jewish museum in Brussels have occurred. In the United Kingdom, Jewish schools have guards and have bomb-proof windows. The Community Safety Trust, whom I met some months ago, have produced the following statistics. In 2014, there were 1,179 anti-Semitic attacks in the United Kingdom. Last year, 924 similar attacks. There have been anti-Semitic attacks on Jewish members of Parliament, Ruth Smith and Luciana Berger. Members, anti-Semitic racism is the oldest type of racism that exists. Sadly, it's not just on the European continent, and it's not just on the mainland of our United Kingdom. The synagogue is in my constituency. And very recently, members will be aware of Rabbi David Singer speaking of the evil anti-Semitic phone calls and emails that he has been receiving as the pastoral leader of the old and established Belfast Jewish community. I have to say that the graffiti recently daubed on the synagogue and in Belfast city centre was absolutely sickening and harked back to the 1930s in Nazi Germany. Sadly, these attacks follow the removal of the Heimherzog plaque on a building in Clifton Park Avenue for the protection of the plaque it was removed. An attack on a mural in Northumberland Street that praised an Ulsterman who worked with the Jewish Defence Forces, the Israeli Defence Forces, and the awful and evil attack on the Jewish sector of the city cemetery in August of this year, when 13 headstones were damaged by a mob carrying bricks, rocks, and hammers. I have to say, having spoken to the rabbi on two occasions, having met with the Belfast Jewish Council, with the Lord Mayor of this city and City Hall, and having visited the synagogue recently, the Jewish community in this city is very fearful of the attacks. Mention has been made of the debate which took place in the Guildhall in Londonderry last week, and those parties who voted for that motion have to take responsibility for raising anti-Jewish tensions here in Northern Ireland, without question. I have spoken to members of the Jewish community. They have told me that is exactly the case. They are friends of mine, and I know it to be true. I have to say that, in terms of making good the damage that was done at the city cemetery, I have met with the Director of Parks and Belfast City Council. I have met with the police at a local level in North Belfast. I have invited the Chief Constable to visit the synagogue, and I have invited the First Minister of Northern Ireland to join with me.
The member agree that the disgusting attack in the city cemetery was merely the culmination in a campaign that has been directed against the Jewish community in Belfast that goes back a long, long way. Not only do we have kids from Israel working on the Dead Sea products stall in Castlecourt being attacked, but also products being torn off supermarket shelves because they come from Israel.
And the member will have an extra minute.
When those people take part in so-called pro-Palestinian rallies, those Palestinian rallies turn out to be anti-Israel rallies. I'm not here to speak about Israel and the what's and the wherefores and whataboutery of Israel. I'm talking about the indigenous Jewish community in this city. And I have to say that as I mentioned, tonight is Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. For those evil people who took part in the attack in the city cemetery, who daub graffiti on the synagogue, who have sent threatening emails to members of the Jewish community, including a rabbi, they need to atone for their evil actions, not just across Europe, but across this United Kingdom. We must stamp out anti-Semitism. And I, for one, for my part, along with my party, will continue to stand firm and support Belfast's small, but I have to say growing Jewish community, because they have provided so much to this city in terms of its cultural life, in terms of its political life, and most importantly in terms of its commercial life, and they continue to do so. The Jewish community is valued in this city. I greatly am privileged to represent the Jewish community in North Belfast, where the synagogue is placed, and I regularly visit there. And I have to say, it is a sad reflection on this city. This city, both nationally and internationally, was damaged reputationally with that vile and evil attack of the city cemetery.
Can the member bring his remarks to a close?
Such actions have to be and rightly condemned across this House, and I'm glad they were.
I call Philip Smith.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. I rise in support of the amendment. Madam Speaker, the First Minister has made a short statement on the 27th of June after the referendum result in the context of increased attacks on migrants in Great Britain. They are reassuring local migrant communities that they are welcome and valued in Northern Ireland. That statement needs to be echoed and amplified once again, and I call on the Executive Office to today reiterate this statement, but with greater volume and more repetition. A few days after the referendum, I was invited to one of the larger and more successful agri-food businesses in my own constituency to speak with the company's management team. There were, from memory, about 18 people there, part of the management team, and the vast majority were from other countries, not originally from the UK or Ireland. They came from a wide variety of EU states, Slovakia, Poland, the Baltic states, and Portugal, to name a few. All these people had long service with the company. I think on average it was 9 years. Most had been promoted during the service in tribute to their skills, motivation and contribution. Many had married while living in Northern Ireland, some to locals, some to other migrants, not necessarily from their own country. They're all bringing up their children in Northern Ireland, putting down roots and making a valuable contribution to both our economy and our society. During the next hour or so of the meeting, these managers detailed to me their fears and concerns that are amplified by the Brexit decision. What will happen to my children as they have UK passports and I do not? Should I proceed with my house purchase? Should I start to look for work outside Northern Ireland? They were all very concerned for their futures, and they were not alone. The business owners were equally concerned for the future of their company, access to labour, access to skills, and access to markets. Our migrant labour community needs to hear from this House. A large unified voice needs to come from here to say that this community continues to be welcome and valued, and will continue to be so, no matter the outworkings of Brexit. I understand that some people are concerned by migration. Indeed, it was said to be one of the main drivers for the Brexit vote. To those people who are genuinely concerned, I would say that Northern Ireland is least affected by migration compared to other UK regions. The latest figure shows that Northern Ireland has a net 1.2 migrants per 1,000 population. Compare that to England at 4.5, 1.9 in Wales and 1.5 in Scotland. Yet all studies show that our migrant worker community makes a significant positive contribution to our economy and society. Madam Speaker, the cause of racial equality and the development of a diverse and vibrant society has taken a knock post-referendum. I call on the Executive Office to include within an action plan tasks that will help instill confidence within the migrant worker community. And a good start would be to send out a clear message today to migrant workers themselves, their families, their employers, and of course the wider Northern Ireland community.
I call Christopher Stelford.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, I'm glad to speak in this debate. You will know that I am very proud to be from Belfast, as other people in this room are. I'm very proud that Belfast enjoys a reputation, a well-deserved reputation, as being in the forefront of being a welcoming and kind city with welcoming and kind people. We can take pride in the fact that the people of Belfast elected a Jew from Hamburg to be the Lord Mayor of their city at a time when Jews across Europe, and indeed on this island, were being subjected to pogroms and persecution. We can be proud of the fact that civil and religious liberty is afforded to all of our citizens, whether they be Jew, Muslim, or Christian. I believe very much in the words, I think it was Shimon Peres, who said that we are all Abraham's children. And those rights which I would afford to others, I afford to myself. Those rights that I would ask of others, I would give to them. Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, I don't believe any child is born hating people. Attitudinally, children see no difference between each other. I've seen this in the case of my own children. My daughter's in P2 and my son's in P1. They both have classmates whose parents came from beyond our shores, and they see no difference between the children in their class who are Polish and Lithuanian and themselves. All around Belfast, we see the positive contribution that has been made by people born beyond our shores. In South Belfast, the most well-established ethnic minority community is, of course, the Chinese. And the Chinese people came to Belfast and invested in our city at a time when nobody wanted to, at a time when the heart was being literally ripped out of the city. So we recognise in government the valuable and positive contribution that people make. And it's important that it's put on record that that is the case. Through the Racial Equality Strategy, the Minority Ethnic Development Fund, the Crisis Fund, the Racial Equality Subgroup, and all the other programmes that the government is responsible for, we give a lead on tackling racism and working to create a place in which every person feels safe and secure. Northern Ireland is a compassionate place, a compassionate society. Over 200 people have been settled here under the Vulnerable Persons Relocation Scheme. These people are here because they are fleeing a hellish war zone. We talked yesterday in the House about the circumstances that have forced people to flee Syria. And I would like to believe that were I ever confronted with circumstances similar to those which those people are facing, that friendly neighbours would let me in. Coordinated action
across government, as evidenced even this week in Hate Crime Awareness Week, involving the Executive Office, the Police Service of Northern Ireland, Victims Support, the Probation Board, the Northern Ireland Housing Executive and the Department of Justice, show that the government does take our responsibilities seriously in these areas, and we are determined to act to protect all of our communities from fear or from persecution. I want to once again just thank members for the contributions that they have made. I think actually in this debate there is broad agreement. There is broad agreement about the direction in which we want to travel, and I think there's a recognition of the need to travel it. We must all recognise that those of us in positions of responsibility have a role to play, and I believe that that is the case for every single member of this House, that we are committed to delivering a society in which everyone feels safe, secure, valued. Yes, I will.
Certainly your intervention when the last speaker was up in terms of your own party, and they rightfully mentioned the disgusting attacks on a Jewish cemetery in a city. But what they didn't go on to mention was that the local community rallied behind the Jewish community to show their abhorrence at the attacks that took place. And when we mention those attacks, we should also just mention the actions taken by the local community. And secondly, when people come onto the streets in support of Palestinians, it's not anti-Jewish. It's against the Israeli attacks in the likes of Gaza and the West Bank, and that's what they're doing.
I'm happy.
The member will have an extra minute.
Thank you.
I would say when there's an intervention given, it should be a short intervention.
I'm absolutely happy to acknowledge that that is the case in terms of the local community. And I myself have seen occasions in the communities that I represent where a dreadful attack takes place and an entire community can be branded like that, usually in the front page of certain newspapers, like that, as a racist ghetto, which is completely removed from the reality of the situation.
The member bring his remarks to a
close. On the ground. I would say to him, very briefly, the ease with which people interchange the word Zionist for the word Jew is deeply disturbing.
But if you choose to take an intervention, on this occasion, we won't be able to give you an extra minute.
There's a good reason not to. I welcome the motion and the debate, and it's right and it's timely for this Assembly to send out a very clear and unambiguous message to people of ethnic minorities and people who have come here to live and work, that their contribution is valued, it's needed, and the denigration of them won't be tolerated anymore. I hope the Executive will deliver on this, and as such we will be supporting the constructive Ulster Unionist Party amendment on this. The racial equality strategy has taken too long. It can't just be about photo opportunities, it can't be about a talking shop. It has to have meaningful actions and targets and accountability. We welcome the publication a number of months now of the racial equality strategy, but we do share the deep frustration at the years that it took to bring that forward and the lack of demonstrable progress on that. We regret the failure to address a number of gaps and imbalances that have led to this region trailing behind in legal protection for black and minority ethnic people. The UN Committee on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination have repeatedly, for almost a decade, highlighted the faults in the race relations orders and its amendments. And I want to ask this government, when will they make those legislative fixes? If ever anything deserved a quick royal prerogative change, it would be this. As Mr. Dixon said, we do need to differentiate between sectarianism and racism. Certainly, they are related cancers for this society, but there is obviously a danger for sectarianism, which I accept is our biggest challenge in that respect, to crowd out in terms of resources and funding and police time the growing issue of racism as well. The same black and minority ethnic funding has to be shared out from projects as diverse as great projects like the Mela in Belfast and projects tackling destitution of refugees and asylum seekers. In no other funding stream would those two needs sit side by side, but we justify it just because they're both addressing the needs of minority ethnic communities. We do also need to be very aware of the language of politicians. A casual N-word here in a tweet or trusting people to go down to the shop, sends the message that that language is acceptable, and it legitimises the demonising of new arrivals and people who are different. Failure to tackle myths, and that was a feature of the Brexit debate that laid the blame of very many societal problems at new arrivers here, was very stark. I took part in a debate very recently with a senior politician who was asked about net migration figures here. The politician didn't know, and when he was advised of the very small figure, because we're almost a net exporter of people, he said that the quantum didn't matter. It was the perception of that there were too many migrants here. And when did it stop being the responsibility of politicians to base our policy on fact and to challenge these myths? It's all too easy, Mr. Speaker, to pin racism on specific communities, and I think that is an issue. We're labelling communities where race hate attacks take place as racist communities, and I'll be very clear, anybody who does attack or do graffiti or intimidate on the basis of racial difference needs to be targeted and very forcibly targeted by the police, but we can't let off the hook higher level and institutional xenophobia that feeds exactly this information. A Business in the Community report published yesterday collects the experience of 25,000 workers around the UK from ethnic minority backgrounds, including in Northern Ireland, and showed that black and minority ethnic backgrounds are underrepresented at every management level. 1 in 8 workers is from an ethnic minority background, but only 1 in 16 management positions is occupied, and 30% of those surveyed had experienced racial harassment or bullying in the workplace. There are a number of recommendations that I won't have time to go into around using public procurement to incentivise racial diversity and for businesses to demonstrate real leadership. Related to this is the need for better regulation of precarious and low-paid work. It's obviously not just a minority ethnic issue, but the horrific stories in the media last week of a gangmaster and workers being kept almost as slaves highlights the need for increased protections and vigilance across society. Madam Speaker, the context of the debate is, of course, Brexit and the fact that tens of thousands of people who are contributing here, who are propping up our public services, who are making a net benefit, have a cloud hanging over their head and have done all year. They don't know if they can sign that lease. They don't know if their kids start a school, if they'll be here in a couple of years. And the use of the language that those people are a bargaining chip for the UK was appalling, and this executive should have been first out the door to condemn that language. We support the motion.
I call Junior Minister Ross to respond to the motion, and the Minister will have 15 minutes.
Thank you very much, Ms. Principal Deputy Speaker. And I want to just first of all thank everyone who has participated in this morning's debate. I think the tone, as Mr. Stalford has said, highlighted the fact that everyone in the Chamber is committed to welcoming the minority ethnic communities and those who are working in our society here in Northern Ireland. I mentioned last week during oral questions how we need to have a greater aspiration than simply building a tolerant society. We need to have one that not only recognises and celebrates the diversity and cultural richness that the modern Northern Ireland is all about. And I think that, as members have said during this debate, we must recognise that migrant workers and ethnic minorities not only contribute to the economic life here, but their contribution to our social, political and cultural life is also incalculable. The skills, talents, fresh perspectives and energy migrants and minority ethnic people bring benefits all of us. And since being appointed as junior minister, I've had the privilege of attending many events with our ethnic communities and seeing firsthand the important role that they play in making Northern Ireland a better place for all of us. And of course, I've long recognised the important role that migration plays for many important sectors here in Northern Ireland, not least the agri-food sector, as some members have alluded to. I want to emphasise that whilst we often use terms like minority ethnic communities or migrants, we are of course talking about families, we're talking about individuals, we're talking about colleagues. I think it's important to put that on record as well. Mrs Cameron, in her contribution, spoke about migration to Northern Ireland over a long period of time. Over the last decade, of course, we've had people from a diverse number of nationalities, cultures and ethnic backgrounds who have come to Northern Ireland to make a new life, joining with existing community and minority ethnic families, including the Chinese community, Indian community and Jewish community, who have lived here for many generations, and of course Irish travellers who have been here for many centuries. Mr McGuigan and his contribution talked about the diversity being reflected in the 2011 census, which reports that there's now over 90 languages spoken in Northern Ireland. So our society is changing. The old ways of seeing things and old prejudices are falling slowly away, and hopefully they are being replaced by a much more cosmopolitan and complex take on life and society. Mr Lynch, in opening the debate and proposing the motion, talked about the importance of the racial equality strategy, and many members have touched on that as well. That strategy, of course, was launched last December, and it's full of ambition and high expectation. It establishes a framework for government departments and others to tackle racial inequalities, to eradicate racism and hate crime, and along with the Together Building United Community strategy, to promote good relations and social cohesion. We must be clear that it will take the work of society as a whole to achieve racial equality, and to ensure that we work towards this common goal, it's important that the opinions of everyone are taken on board. By sharing experience and knowledge, we can collectively address the issues of racial inequality and work towards a fully inclusive society, and that's exactly how it should be. The mention has also been made of the subgroup. I was pleased to join with both my junior minister colleague and the First and Deputy First Minister recently at the inaugural meeting of that equality subgroup. And I think it's important that the subgroup has a voice that will be heard at the very highest level of government. And I'm pleased with the feedback that we've already had from participants. And I know they're meeting again next month. A number of members talked about hate crime. And of course, the original motion is explicit around reports of an 87% increase of hate-related crimes over the last 4 years. Mr Lynch also talked about silent voices, and I think that's something which we should recognise, that historically racism and racist incidents have been underreported. And we can look at statistics in different ways, but I think actually in one sense an increased number of reported incidents shows that people now from ethnic backgrounds are more confident in coming forward to say when they have been the victim of such racist attacks or abuse. And it also shows that there's more confidence in the police. However, irrespective of what's behind the statistics, it remains a source of shame and causes damage to our reputation of our society and our economy, and must be challenged. Whilst hate crime is first and foremost a matter for the criminal justice system, the police service, the PPS, and the courts, we must all play our role in challenging it at every turn. I'm aware that behind statistics there are real individuals who have been abused, insulted, who are frightened, intimidated, and increasingly can be isolated in society as well. We've heard a number of members raise specific issues in their own constituencies, and it's important that they highlighted that. Mr. McPhillips, in his contribution, mentioned the issue of the European referendum. It's important, again, to put on record that the post-Brexit spike in race hate crime in England and Wales is not reflected in Northern Ireland. It's received considerable media coverage, but the evidence that we have has suggested that actually in Northern Ireland racist attacks are actually falling, and that should be welcomed. I think it's important to also say that the referendum did not create racism. The calling of the referendum didn't cause it, and the result isn't going to either bring about more racism or get rid of racism, and I would caution against members who draw that link, because in all societies there are always those who resent, fear and hate those who are different from them based on race, gender or religion. These people are wrong, they're misguided and they're misinformed, and we have to, as I've said, challenge that. What I think is encouraging, and again mention was made of the Life and Times survey that in 2015, that 61% of people living in Northern Ireland actually think that the culture and traditions of minority ethnic people adds to the richness and diversity of the Northern Ireland society. And it also found that 68% of people here said it's important to them that public bodies like local councils, hospital trusts and government departments take into account the needs of ethnic minorities. And of course that has also been my experience in attending some of the events that have taken place around Community Relations and Cultural Awareness Week, and how many people have participated to learn more about what's going on there. Mr Beattie proposed the amendment. Of course he was critical of the executive, as is a running theme perhaps since we have returned since the Assembly election. He talked about his own experience of living abroad and the challenges that there are for ethnic minorities or newcomers to Northern Ireland living here, and I think that's absolutely right. It is quite a courageous thing to move to a new country and a new culture. But I am continually encouraged by talking to people who have started a new life in Northern Ireland, particularly those who have been part of the refugee resettlement programme, and how welcoming they have found people in Northern Ireland. Now, undoubtedly it's challenging for them, but they have emphasised how welcome they have been made to feel. He mentioned about the review of legislation. I know there's been media reports in the last few weeks about this. A number of members mentioned that as well. We are, as an executive, aware of the suggestion of gaps in legislation. The Racial Equality Strategy, of course, commits to a review of the current legislation, including a review of the current Race Relations Order and Fair Employment legislation. Mr Agnew and Mrs Hannah and others made comment on that. It's worth pointing out, of course, the...
Would the Minister agree that rather than perhaps a piecemeal approach to the review of various individual pieces of legislation, that we should actually be looking at a single Equality Act?
Actually, it's an important point to make. The statute book is an incredibly messy thing. There could be piecemeal approaches to different pieces of legislation that could all be encompassed in a consolidation bill of some sort, and it's something that the Executive Office will look at. So we're going to examine the statute book, what pieces of legislation are there, and if a consolidation bill is required, that will be something that we will give consideration to. Talking about specifically about refugees, I'd mentioned about the courage it takes to come here. The Department has supported the programme through the assisting the humanitarian crisis through the Vulnerable Persons Relocation Scheme, and it's currently the only formal scheme that we receive refugees, but it has been successful. Over 200 people from Syria have now resettled here under the scheme, and as I said, have been made to feel welcome, and again, feedback has been very encouraging on that, and we expect to be consulting on the refugee integration strategy later on this year. In terms of the draft programme for government, it sets out in outcome terms the improvements in wellbeing to which the executive aspires for everyone living in Northern Ireland, and we remain committed to the implementation of the racial equality strategy, and we'll be working over the coming weeks to explore how its implementation can support the achievement of the PFG outcomes, in particular with reference to addressing the issues raised by minority ethnic communities. In terms of action plan, I'm not going to give away, because I only have 5 minutes left and there's a lot of contributions I want to get through, and I hope he forgives me for that. I generally do give away. In terms of action plans, timetable, priorities, look, the Racial Equality Strategy subgroup have a significant role to play in making sure that things are moved forward at a quick pace. They will be advising the Executive Office and other government departments on the implementation of the strategy. They will be tasked with working with the departments and vice versa to develop an implementation plan and monitoring and reviewing progress on implementation. And I think that's an important role that they have. To touch on some of the other comments of members, Mr Irwin mentioned the fact that Northern Ireland is a welcoming place. I think that is borne out by some of the conversations I've had with people who have resettled here. He talked about a particular incident in his own constituency, which of course should be condemned, and the importance of working with police to ensure those responsible are held accountable for their actions and dealt with appropriately when brought in front of the courts. Of course, this is Hate Crime Awareness Week. I and Junior Minister Fearn will be joining with the Justice Minister later on this week to highlight some of the issues around race crime and how we can tackle those attitudes in society. Mr McPhillips talked about the failure to tackle the issue. Look, we all have a responsibility about this. Members have said this before. Political parties have responsibilities in terms of what their members put on social media. Councillors have a responsibility in terms of motions that they support and the impression that that gives out to society as well. He talked about investment. There's £60 million to the T-Buck strategy over the next 5 years, which is hugely important. Both he and Mrs Hannah talked about financial support to minority ethnic groups. The Minority Ethnic Development Fund is as successful as it's always been. In fact, it's more successful than has been previously. And since the fund was established in 2001, it supported hundreds of different projects and helped thousands of people. Over £1 million is being distributed through the Minority Ethnic Development Fund to assist minority ethnic and local community organisations to promote good relations between people of different ethnic backgrounds. Over 30 projects are being supported in this financial year. I think it's important to highlight as well that the number of applications is increasing year on year. So for 2013-15, 85 applications were received. This increased to 92 applications for the 15-16 fund and increased again for the 16-17 fund to a total of 99 applications. And I think that's indicative of the fact that there's a growing confidence of minority ethnic groups of coming forward and wanting to not only highlight issues that are of concern to them, but also promote and celebrate the role that they play in Northern Ireland. There's also, of course, the Crisis Fund, £100,000 budget. That's established to assist vulnerable migrants, destitute refugees and asylum seekers, those who have been subjected to trafficking, and my colleague mentioned the bill that was passed here and the additional powers that that has created, and other identifiable vulnerable groups, including the Roma, and I know that that has been raised as well. Mr Dixon talked about the need to tackle this issue of racism. He's exactly right when he said that. That's why we have the strategy, why we have the subgroup up and running, and actually I'm encouraged by the feedback we've had, as I've said many times before. He talked about the isolation felt by many ethnic groups. I mean, that's not what we're hearing from the subgroup, who feel that they are now being listened to at the highest level of government. I think that's something which is very encouraging. Mrs Cameron talked about the incident in Antrim. I think all of us were horrified when we viewed the video footage of that, and people right across the country have rightly been disgusted. She also talked about the importance that migrant community workers have in our health service, and I think that everybody again would agree with that. Mr Humphrey talked about the impact on the Jewish community in Northern Ireland. I think it's worrying that particularly in Great Britain we're seeing what seems to be a rise in anti-Semitism in one of our main parties over there, and he talked specifically about the harassment of the Jewish community in Northern Ireland. I think it's important that this House condemns all types of racism, all types of intolerance, whether it's based on ethnicity, whether it's based on religion, sexual orientation or anything else, and we shouldn't be tolerating it. Mr Smith talked about the referendum again. I think I've cautioned members about linking the referendum with the scourge of racism in our society. He said that we need to echo the statement by the First and Deputy First Minister when they talked about the importance and value of migrant workers in Northern Ireland. I think it's not just the words, but actually it's the actions. And I know that officials within the Executive Office have been in contact with minority communities and migrant workers in Northern Ireland to reassure them that they're very much part of Northern Ireland fabric and part of the society, advising them their rights and continuing that long-standing relationship that we have with them. He said it's important that we state how valuable they are. I haven't heard a single person say that we don't support the migrant community in Northern Ireland, nor have I heard a single person saying that they shouldn't be remaining here post-Brexit. I think that's a comment that Mr Stalford talked about as well when he talked about the positive contribution and the fact that many children are in much more diverse schools than has been the case before. So I think that the contributions today have clearly demonstrated the breadth and depth of support here for the executive's work towards achieving racial equality and good race relations. We recognise that racial equality and good race relations are essential if we're to flourish, but I would counsel there's no quick fix to this. There will be a sustained effort on the part of government departments, public and private sector organisations and businesses and individuals, and I'm proud of the work that this department and the executive has done in trying to achieve those goals. I don't think anybody underestimates the challenge that exists. But I think that through the Racial Equality Strategy, the Minority Ethnic Development Fund, the Crisis Fund, the Racial Equality Subgroup and other programmes, we will continue to make sure that we make progress on this issue.
I call Mike Nesbitt to wind on the amendment.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. So we have a motion and we have an amendment. A motion which is much more than warm words. If it is more than that, woolly words, confused words about budgets and how they relate to strategies, but in the amendment from my colleague Mr Beattie, something concrete, something that says let's have action plans, let's have timetables, let's have priorities so we know where we're going. Is that not consistent with this new executive commitment to outcome-based accountability government? The very thing being talked about in this city in a two-day conference, which will come here to Parliament buildings later in the day. If we're looking for a real clue about the executive's commitment in this area, where better could we look than the very important letter penned by the First Minister and Deputy First Minister, acting jointly, to the Prime Minister of the United Kingdom on the 10th of August, highlighting five concerns about the implications for Northern Ireland when we leave the European Union. The letter stating the blindingly obvious. One of the concerns was about migrant workers and a plea to the Prime Minister to recognise that we need to be allowed access to unskilled as well as highly skilled labour in both the public and in the private sector. But no recognition that we value these people as more than the commodity that they were defined as in that letter. Merely as a commodity. Do we really value them? Do the executive really value them? Because we saw today the fault line with one half, quite rightly, talking about the valuable contribution over the years of the Jewish community in Belfast, and the other half supporting attacks on the state of Israel. And I do know we can't conflate ethnicity with nationality. But there is the fault line. And the member for South Belfast brings in the contribution of the Chinese community down the years, during some very difficult years. I notice he failed to mention the Indian community. For example, Diljit Rana, who came here in very difficult times and decided to build a business empire and found it rather difficult because every time he opened a business, Republicans blew it up. I may exaggerate on every time because he did obviously get there eventually, Principal Deputy Speaker. Principal Deputy, sorry, is it 5 or 10? 5? 5 minutes. Mr. Lynch says ethnics have never felt more insecure, as if his party hasn't been in government and in charge for the last 9.5 years, as if there hasn't been a long hiatus between the racial equality strategies, as if the stakeholders, like the Council for Ethnic Minority, don't think this new strategy is a retrograde step. And the Minority Ethnic Development Fund, which saw another hiatus, why was it that we told groups that we would fund the gap last year and then changed our minds? We, sitting on this estate, dealing in billions of pounds, saying to these small groups, you're going to have to go to the bank or wherever you go to, and you're going to have to find some sort of bridging loan to see yourselves through. I don't think it is fair. I don't think it reflects a proper commitment to our ethnic minorities, Principal Deputy Speaker. I have to say I'm a little disappointed with some of the quality of the debate. Mr. Humphreys seems to Mr. Irwin seems to think we're a welcoming country because travel journalists think we're a welcoming country. I don't know what that has to do with this. And Mrs. Pameron says that since the 1600s, Northern Ireland has a long tradition. She's as confused as the First Minister. Northern Ireland isn't even 100 years old. There's a big tradition in the northeast of this island, but not in Northern Ireland. And Mrs. Hannah does talk about the failure to tackle myths. Well, I have to say, we are in danger of moving into a post-factual society. And the new realities and the new normals is that Northern Ireland is no longer a binary state of orange and green, unionists and nationalists, and that is why we should support the amendment to this motion.
I hear him, sir. Cathal Boylan. I call Cathal Boylan, who will have 10 minutes.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. And I want to read a few words onto the record, and then I want to pick up on some of the contributions. Although I have to commend the Minister. I mean, he must have been reading my notes. I mean, the Minister's picked up on the... I want to take this opportunity to commend the Executive on its vision for the T-Buck strategy, which outlines a vision of a united community based on equality of opportunity, the desirability of good relations and reconciliation, one which is strengthened by its diversity, where cultural expression is celebrated and embraced, and where everyone can live, learn, work and socialise together, free from prejudice, hate and intolerance. The strategy seeks to address the deep-rooted issues that have perpetuated segregation and resulted in some people living separate lives. It is important to note the T-Buck strategy is a journey towards a more united and shared society. There is clearly a long and difficult process of change and development for our own society here in the north of Ireland. I believe strategies such as T-Buck and the racial equality strategy demonstrate that this Assembly is trying to challenge sectarianism, racism and prejudice. It is important that we have a joined-up approach in government to tackle all these problems. Notwithstanding the comments that have been made in the various EU and UN reports alluded to by my party colleagues, the T-Buck strategy recognises the very serious problems we face here in the North in tackling sectarianism, prejudice and hate. One of the shared aims of the strategy is to continue to improve attitudes amongst our young people and to build a community where they can play a full and active role in building good relations. I want to highlight one example of the shared educational campus of St John's Primary School in the Mai and the Regional Primary School in the Mai, selected by the Department of Education as one of our new shared campuses that will be created over the next number of years. As well as three shared educational campuses, other initiatives include getting 10,000 young people not in education, employment or training a place on the new United Youth Volunteering Programme, establishing 10 new shared housing schemes, developing 4 urban village schemes, developing a significant programme of cross-community sporting events, removing interface barriers by 2023, and pilot 100 shared summer schools. If we are to measure the success of TBUC, look at what outcomes have been achieved. In addressing all of the issues that we face here in the North, we must not forget the Good Friday Agreement, where the Declaration of Support commits. Yeah, okay.
I mean this with the greatest respect for the member. He spent minutes saying targets that were set about 3 years ago and washed over the outcomes that have been achieved without referencing any.
Well, it's a work in progress, and you know. I'll answer the member this way, because the member has actually come into the chamber at the end of the process. Hasn't really been listening in, so it's a wee bit rich of him. I was good enough to give him the intervention, but I know it's a work in progress, and I know the junior minister Fearn has been doing a lot of work, like junior minister Ross. So if the member doesn't mind, I'll continue on with the speech. The Declaration of Support commits all participants to the protection and vindication of the human rights of all. In sections on rights, safeguards and equality of opportunity, the signatories affirm their commitment to the mutual respect, civil rights and the religious liberties of everyone in the community, and we need to continue to see this implemented. That's according to the Good Friday Agreement. That is why, Preve last concorded, it is important that the departmental equality schemes are robustly implemented. And I just want to go back to the original part when it started off, because I've written down exactly what the Minister written down in terms of all the debates here of the same notes, but I'm not going to go through all of what has been said. But I will say this, because my colleague turned around and said at the very start, and if you read, if those people who actually read the actual motion itself, and I've heard words like Wally and Doug Beattie talked about being weak, because the member got up and says that the executive was committed to these two strategies. But I think the main point that he highlighted, and I think that we would have agreement in this chamber on, is a single Equality Act, which a number of members, including I just can't even think, Stephen Agnew and others, has mentioned on the floor of the House. That's what we're talking about. You know, so we all know what the Equality Commission is saying. We all know what the UN reports are saying. And, you know, I have recorded everything that the members have said here, and I'll pick out a few brief points, because let's start with Mr Beattie, because I've touched on the only other point I want to make in terms of my own colleague, Mr Lynch, because you mentioned this here, and the minister picked, the junior minister picked up on as well, was the issue of silent voices. And that is a concern for us, and it's something we certainly need to look at. But I want to talk about Mr Beattie's contribution, because Mr Beattie certainly shared some of his experiences. But I would have thought, in all honesty, and he's right, he finished his remarks by saying it sits with the ministers, and I agree with that. I think, but we all collectively have to take responsibility. But there's another issue, you know. He spoke for 7.5 minutes, and it's not for me to say what his contribution was about, but I will say this here. His last three lines was only about those three words, and I would have thought there was an opportunity when he talked about an action plan, timetable and key priorities. I would have thought this was the forum and an opportunity for people to bring some suggestions forward in relation to that. And I would have liked to have seen a contribution to that, because even Mr Nesbitt, when he was winding up, I thought he would have had an opportunity. It's okay putting the motion to the foot, because at the end of the day, as part of your contribution, it says it sits with ministers, and still, if you read the substantive motion, it is talking about the ministers and responsibility. So, I mean, I don't, you know, the issue is, I don't know how bringing those 3 points without any reference to what exactly we could, how we'd achieve that, or what your ideas were, because we know, and I sit on the ethnic minorities group now as ethnic minority spokesperson. We'll have a meeting next week, and we'll go through this debate and we'll see exactly what it was. But I think there was an opportunity for the debate to expand out into that. No, I just want to finish off some of our comments to be fair to the member. I normally do, but I just want to pick up some other points. Richard McPhillips picked up a good point because he's right about the Brexit issue, because there are concerns now after the Brexit issue and the vote in terms of Europe that these issues has raised its head. There's no doubt about it. The attacks have you know, grown, so there are concerns about that. Mr Dixon always makes a good contribution, but I have to say the issue of the as we've had Rich picking on the Justice Minister after having the Justice Ministry for 5 years, and the Justice Minister wasn't here, to be fair. But he did, and he's continues to be fair to me, has always mentioned this. He's always supported the idea of a single equality bill, and he keeps mentioning that all the time, along with ourselves. I want to just pick up on that point. Mr McGuigan highlighted some of the issues in terms of it's shocking to think of there's like 500 race hate incidents in the last 6 months. And I mean, that certainly is very worrying and something we need to look at. Just a few other points I want to pick up on Claire Hannah's contribution. She's not here at the minute, but I think there's something in terms of we need to look at the legal framework. And I think that the Minister did say that he would, he made as part of his contribution, say that they would look at examining the statute book, you know, so I think that is a positive comment in relation to that. But like I say, through you, Preeve, Ilias Kenkoyle, that's me. I'll just finish that. I support the motion and I'm against the amendment. Gormil Mogat.
The question is that the amendment standing on the marshal list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
All those in clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes.
Order, members. Order. Members will resume their seats. Order. Members will resume their seats. The question is that the amendment standing on the Marshall list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, if any, no.
No.
Do we have tellers? Order. Order. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Mike Nesbitt and Doug Beattie. Tellers for the noes are Cathal Boylan and Philip McGuigan. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Order. Members will resume their seats. I will ask the clerk to read the result.
Simple majority division result. 72 members voted, 30 members voted aye, 42 members voted no. The amendment therefore falls.
The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. I think the ayes have it. The ayes have it.